He did not heal everybody. In one instance, at Matthew 13, I believe, he didn't do many works because there was a lot of unbelief in that town. So no, he didn't heal people in that town. But number two, I think of the lame man at the gate beautiful. Acts chapter 4, I believe 3 or 4. It says that he was lame from birth.
Thank you. Tell us.
Used, bomber band
characters. I actually got a lot of criticism because I'm not just saying it's universal. Because we come from very strict Pentecostalism, and they couldn't understand how I could go to a secular university, but I felt the call of the Lord to do that. So I got my master's and master's in education, but I never laid my Bible down.
Yeah. Well, once again, it's an individual thing. So I'm wondering if you know that. If God is dealing with you about ministry, he'll open that door.
Yeah.
And
that's the dying of the sofa.
To a connection with I'm watching something and I hear something you know, I don't throw a fit because I understand these are not Christians. You know, it's like flying like I do in airports. I mean, you hear everything under the sun. Well, I don't get, you know, I don't go jump on people, but if they're sinners, they don't know. That's the way they're talking. But I just, what I try to do is live my life to where I'm not doing that. And when it came to my kids, Debbie and I monitored what they watch, what they listen to.
As we should.
We did that, and don't regret one moment of
that.
I'm not
afraid.
And I think the fact that all three are saved and loving the Lord and serving the Lord and active in their churches, very
much so. This is different.
So
you know, homeboy, what are
you
doing?
You're trying to stop.
Lord, thank you. Yeah, please. Who else drives
that? What the food? And sometimes I'd come to the house and I would see something on television that the Lord would be watching. And you sat there and
well, you didn't tell me what that was.
He said, something on the bed being portrayed. Well, I didn't just walk through the room and leave it.
Oh, couldn't you
not? I stopped there and I said, well, what are you watching? Let's analyze it. Well, they didn't like that.
And that threw down was
10:41
a.m. The wisdom of fools on dope. Well, that's foolish too. We still got the on dope in there. You're gonna get it for that. But that at what time I showed you? It was foolish.
And
she'll be going again. Okay, they'll be going again.
Responsibility humility in how we treat brothers and sisters in the Lord. When, you know, look at when the church in Jerusalem was under great persecution and they were losing their jobs, losing their homes, and so they sold, bought everything, and helped one another. Well, you notice they didn't do that for non-Christians. That was only done for themselves. So I think that we need to understand that we have a higher responsibility that comes from how and what we do to those that are brothers and sisters in the Lord.
Right. Be good unto all men, but especially good to those in the household of faith.
I hear you.
Yeah.
You can go back to sleeping because I disturb you sleep. Even though you do me like that every day.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah.
Now, if from Michigan, you're on the air. Oneida?
No, he didn't.
Are you there? Okay, I guess she's not. What does Matthew chapter 10, verse 37 mean? Alright, let's get over there to that. Matthew 10, verse 37. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Well, it goes back to what I said
almost 2 hours ago
when I made the comment, we must not allow anyone, husband, wife, son, daughter, mother, father, sister, brother, we must not allow anyone to come between us and our relationship with the Lord. What this is really speaking of is who has the preeminence in our life. That's what it means. It's not meaning some have tried to take this, well, you know, I've got to do this for God. I don't care what condition my parents are in and, you know, they need me, but I'm not, you know, that's not what that means. It just means in the heart, the preeminence in your heart is for the things of God. How would y'all comment on that?
I would say when it comes to your personal intimate relationship with Christ, and a brother, your earthly brother or your parents would say, you're either going to come in this house and forget this Jesus stuff, or you're set to walk away on your own and you have to make a decision, you know, that I will follow the Lord. The old song says, I have decided to follow him. Mama, don't go, I'm going anyway. In that area.
Yeah.
In that.
But that, you know, the whole idea is 37, 38, 39. It really falls into the category of discipleship.
Yes.
That's really what it falls under. And our desire as a Christian should be the Lord and the things of the Lord come first. But if the Lord, now here's the key, if the Lord has his proper place in your life, there will never be a question of ignoring the needs of others around you.
Right. And, you know, God calls out our excuses, too. Luke chapter 9 kind of talks about the cost of discipleship. He tells one person, follow me, he says, well, let me go bury my father. That was an excuse. Jesus isn't against burying somebody, but he called him out as an excuse. Don't let the dead bury the dead. You need to follow me. Listen to the call. Another person, well, let me go bid farewell first. He who puts one hand on the plow and looks back is not worthy. God calls us out on our excuses. He knows our heart. He knows us better than we know us. So if what we're saying is just excuses as to reasons why God doesn't come first, he's going to call us out on it. God has to be preeminent above everybody and everything. He is our all in all. We should be a living sacrifice, Paul would say, according to Romans 12. And that is our reasonable service. That's our reasonable worship. Jesus sacrificed himself for us. We should be willing to live for him and put him first.
That's perfect. That sums it up perfectly. Hey, man, just curious. does he say? I have not read yet. I'll start with you, Tom.
I don't know. I wasn't there when he died. So it would be very difficult for me to answer that question. I just think that he got himself in a big mess with all those wives.
I think he was. First of all, this is why Solomon made it right. You gotta say, first of all, there's no way the Holy Spirit would include the writings of a person that died lost.
He used to go up to his studio, boy.
No way, in any shape or fashion.
That's usually logic, but I agree with it.
And then came back to steal some of that stuff. She was foolish.
That's exactly right. He had sown to the wind, or the world reaped the whirlwind. He had tried the pleasures of sin. He had the money, the richest man in the world. He had tried all of that. And he found it was all vanity of vanities. And he says in the 13th verse of the 12th chapter, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God, keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. That's not the words of a backslidden man. That's the words of a man who has come to the end of everything the world has to offer and found that the world doesn't offer anything.
They hid me trying to knock out my stumping, trying to knock out my camera.
And third, there's a third
Solomon, anything they can, that's who they are,
is a type of the warring Christ. David was a type of the warring Christ. He fights our battles. But Solomon is a type of the millennial Christ. Well, how do you get that? Because under the rule of Solomon, first of all, Jerusalem was the richest city in the world, and Israel was the richest
city in the world. Everybody need to get down, my boy. Okay, big boy.
There was no war. Not one.
Let's sit down. I want you getting comfortable.
Because of Israel's
never been.
And as Pastor said, I had to come see for myself, and the half has not yet been told. And that was a picture of the coming millennial reign. So God doesn't use these types of shadows of things or individuals who are profligate. He just doesn't do that. That's funny, guys. I got an email a long time. I don't think I read it. You know, friend said, what are you guys talking about, types of shadows? Are y'all making
that
up?
How would you know that?
Believe me, we're not making that up. That is Bible Theology 101. You'll find that in Bible school, how that certain things in the Bible are. Things in the Bible carried out in the natural portray a spiritual application. That's the whole point. That's type, and that's shadow. Moses was a type of Christ. He's called the Christ of the Old Covenant. And so all these things, types, shadows. So God would never allow a type or a shadow to be used on something coming prophetically that is glorious and wonderful and majestic from someone who was profligate. One last greatest email. Brother Bates, I love the song you sing. Is this not the land of Beulah? I'd really like to know who Beulah is.
Beulah means marriage.
But the land of Beulah, that's really a name for Israel. Yeah. And it was a name of Israel. But it's speaking the type in a shadow is Jesus. Is not this the land of Beulah? As Israel, the land of milk and honey, that provided everything in a visible realm for Israel to survive. Christ,
Lord, thank
is
you.
Our land of Beulah. And I'm listening to the very that's a great song.
It's old. I was looking it up, and it's even in the old Mennonite books. And I was going back and looking. And it's,
yeah, it's a better way going back.
We'll give you a rest.
Well, they want you to know that they love your
precious. Come on.
It is a great version. We've got to go. And thank you so much for being with us today. Tonight, as I said, Brother Bates will be ministering in song and in word at the midweek study, the Bible study here at Family Worship Center tonight. We will be with us in the sanctuary. Please tune in live. And as I said earlier, let others know about it that may not know the music ministry, the preaching ministry of this dear brother. And they need to hear what he has to say, and they need to hear the music as well, because it will be a blessing to them. And understand something, I don't say that about anybody unless I believe that they will make a difference in the life of the hearer of that person. So be sure and tune in and be with us, and we'll be back tomorrow. Now, I've got to say this. Gabriel and I are having to separate our time to be with Dad, and it may be that until Mother's able to get back, we may have to run a rerun or two on this program. But we're doing our best not to do that, but we're only two people, and we've got work here and an obligation for family at home. And so you need to pray for us, and that the Lord will work on it.
Are you going for it?
We're working through it. We love you.
I don't have anything to eat yet, so I'm in the mood. Now they stand over by the window, the front window, and just open. We got a machine going on. You just sitting there like you saw me bring in food. Not yet. Even in the game killer.
The girl that was laughing at him, but they friends.
She was spooning.
That's where she moved to. It was spooning.
What a delight to be with you today. This is Pastor Gabriel Swire, along with the two Daves. Now finally back, and we got Dr. Dave Watts, Brother David Ward. We're so glad to have both these guys here with us today. We're glad to have each and every single one of you tuning in. We like to say it this way, thank you for making this program a part of your day. Now, before we get started into our teaching today, we're just beginning in the month of June. And so literally the half of the year has already gone by. And we're now on the downside of 2024. And it's kind of hard to believe that we're already beginning that downward slope for 2024, and which means that 2025 will be here before you know it.
Let me go check this.
It's your day going on. It's just like that. And Brother Dave was talking about when we were kids, that summer vacation, you know, it was 2.5 months, I guess it was, something like that, maybe 3 months. But that summer vacation, it felt like an eternity. And now,
two, three months,
it goes by like a week, you know. And, I want to make this quick reminder, seeing that we are beginning the month of June, we've got a couple of quick things that we would like to bring up regarding the college. Do you have the dates of your 1 week intensive? We've got 2 more 1 week intensives that are coming up. One very soon, in fact, it's beginning next week. And then the second, of course, you can see it right there next month, the 12th. We've got these two intensives.
Well, we're thankful.
If you're able to make it to either one of these events, you need to do so. It's $50 a person. These are not only available for the our students at JSBC, but this is really the only means that we have available for non-students, for audit students, for those who just want to come to sit in and to learn about a particular subject. Watts is teaching on a subject that I feel is very important for pastors. You are a pastor of the church, and you have the resources to come down here for a week, June 10th to the 14th. For that week, I know that the deadline is pretty much nearing. It's nearing the deadline for you to register. But if you're able to make it, you need to, that this final push, you need to make it. You need to be down here, because every pastor, every minister of the gospel, every evangelist, every missionary, whatever you may be, you need to understand what it takes to study the Bible. How to study the Bible. It's a hermeneutical approach, if you will, to studying the Word of God. And let me say this, studying the Word of God is an art. It really is an art. There's an art and a science to studying the Word of God.
Thank you.
You may not like that statement, but really, that's it's a true statement. It's an art and it's a science. And there are ways to go through and study the Word of God that will be a major benefit to you as a minister. And maybe you're not a minister, maybe you're not a pastor, but you want to know more about studying the Word of God. You need to take this class. Like I said, deadline's approaching. In fact, it may have already passed, as it already passed. And so there may be a little way for you maybe to come in on the last moment. But
if somebody wants
is to contact school@jsbc.edu. If you want to email me, david.watts@jsm.org, we'll be able to work that out. Yeah. But the official deadline is closed. But we, if you want to come last minute, we'll make an exception. We'll be able to get you in. And this class is for minister, lay person alike, like you said. Hermeneutics is just the art and science of Bible study. Obviously, we talk about it a lot. The Holy Spirit ultimately reveals to us the meaning of the text, but there are good hermeneutical tools that we can use to sharpen our Bible study that I believe if we use these good sound tools and we allow the Holy Spirit to work in us, we're going to be better students of the Bible. We're going to be, there's a lot of pastors that I have run across who were not able to have a formal Bible college education. And they are men that I respect, men that I love, and they've told me, hey, you know, God has helped me a lot in my ministry, my preaching, but he said, oh, look, they're like, it's a school of hard knocks. They said, if I would have been able to go to Bible college,
or is that someone, a mentor?
A mentor, somebody to show them some of these things. They say, you know, early on, my teaching and preaching would have been light years better because these things are not, for whatever reason, a backlash against Bible college Christian higher education. I don't get it. These things are designed to help you in your local church. Our goal at JSBC, we want to develop researchers, we want to develop scholars, but our main heartbeat is the local church and helping the local church. Practical ministry, pastors, youth pastors, evangelists, equipping the local church. So How to Study the Bible is going to be very practical. There are two gentlemen that I had the privilege of meeting, Drs. Duval and Haynes.
Yes.
Their text, Grasping God's Word, is the main text of this class, and they are both humble guys. Now imagine having a hermeneutics textbook that's a very, very, very specified academic field, but that textbook has sold over a million copies.
Right.
That's how good how Grasping God's Word is. There's some other hermeneutics textbooks that I would recommend too, but I believe Grasping God's Word is the best one, and that's the basis for what we teach at the college. That's exactly what you're going to get in this intensive. And I believe we use good hermeneutical tools, and we allow the Holy Spirit to give us the interpretation. We as preachers endeavor to stick to the text as close as we possibly can and get the meaning. What is the author saying to the original audience, and what is he saying here in 2024? Because God has spoken to them first, and he's speaking to us now. Everything in the Bible is applicable for our life and living today. We've just got a session that we've got to find it. So it's going to be a great class. Dr. Dupree's class is also going to be very practical. Every pastor, or those that want to be a pastor, or want to be an evangelist, want to be a missionary, you need to make his class in July, because he's going to draw from his wealth of pastoral experience practical ministry. You know, there's no way we can prepare you for everything that might happen in the pastoral ministry, because anything can happen. But if we can get you ahead of the curve and give you some good practical tools that he's going to draw from, he's got experience on the evangelistic field, on the missions field, in the local church, it's going to be a very, very valuable thing and endeavor to be a part of that. So I want to definitely recommend Brother Lauren's Book of Ruth was more theological, but out of that, everybody who attended that got a lot of great notes to take back to their church to teach the message of the cross, which is all typological in the Book of Ruth. It's, if you don't see Christ in the Book of Ruth, then you're not looking, I don't know what to say. So very good class for his, lots of great practical things to take back and teach. I'm very excited about my class, and very excited about Dr. Lucrece's class. So this is going to be a good summer of intensive. And just to make it clear, you can send me your hate mail, but these classes are not available online. They're not available. You have to be in person.
Yeah, I had somebody at somebody in church a few weeks ago. They pulled me off and they said, will these 1 week intensives be taped? I said, no, they won't. I'm like, why won't they be taped? I'm like, because you won't be here. And then you leave. Well, I won't be here. You know, that don't care. I'm sorry.
We are way ahead of the curve as far as broadcasting services, broadcasting. We have people say, well, do you have anything distance education? We have an entire Association of Arts available distance education. So we are pro-distance education, but not every class is available online to everybody. These are designed. We want you on campus. We want you immersed in the campus experience for a week. And it's not a thing. It's just that's how it is. And so again, send on your hate mail, Pastor B.
I thought you said you were going
to pass it on forward to you.
Okay, you're for it. Thank you.
What a nice guy.
Appreciate the love.
Yeah.
Shows you how much he cares about me.
That's what friends are for.
Yeah, that's what friends are for. Yeah, who needs enemies when you got friends like that, you know? But
The other thing, we didn't catch up on, obviously, IYC, I'll be available before and after every service of IYC.
And speaking of IYC, you need to make your plans now to be here for that. You can see the dates on the screen, the 24th and the 28th. This is going to be two conferences in one. Yeah. Two conferences in one. You're going to have the youth conference and the children's conference going on at the same time. IYC, IKC, going on at the same time, different locations. And so for parents, you're trying to think about, you know, which one I'm going to bring my kids to. Now you can bring your kids to both of them. You know, the little kids will be with Pastor Jonathan in the Cross Auditorium. Teenage will be with Pastor Harris and Pastor Sean for IYC. So you need to get all the information you can for that. Go to a website available online. You can get all the information and register as soon as possible. And you can see that information once again on the screen. All right, let's get back to our study here. I want to just pick up where we left off, and I want to just read verse 16, 17. And 18 here today of Ephesians chapter 6. Well, as I mentioned last week, we're coming to a close, and even though we have covered the shield of faith, I want to cover the fiery darts just for a moment, and then continue on with the helmet of salvation, and of course with the sword of the Spirit and with prayer. I believe those aspects are very important. So let's go ahead and read, beginning in verse 16. I'm going to ask Dr. Watts to read the text. I'll read the notes, and then we will our teaching on this last section of the book of Ephesians chapter 6. We're reading from the Expositor Study Bible, the Cross of our edition. You can follow along with us on the screen. Go ahead, Doc.
Above all, taking the shield of faith,
ever making the cross of the object of your faith, which is the only faith God will recognize, and the only faith Satan will recognize.
Wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked.
This represents temptations with which Satan assails the saints.
And take the helmet of salvation.
Has to do with the renewing of the mind, which is done by understanding that everything we receive from the Lord comes to us through the cross.
And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
The Word of God is the story of Christ and the cross.
Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit.
And incessant pleading until the prayer is answered.
And watching thereunto.
Being sensitive to what the Holy Spirit desires.
With all perseverance.
Don't stop.
And supplication.
Petitions and requests.
For all saints.
Saints praying for other saints. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus. We ask for your help in delineating the Scriptures and studying the Scriptures. Anoint us to teach. You know, I find it interesting, guys, that after Paul presents the idea, he already lists several weapons that we have at our disposal. Not really weapons, but the tools that we have. The belt, the belt of truth, the fichon, the preparation of gospel, peace, breastplate of righteousness. And then the moment he talks transitions and makes one little statement. And he says that you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. I want to talk a little bit about these fiery darts. And of course, I'm going to ask the guys here, the two Daves, to jump in at any point. But I don't want to just overlook these fiery darts. I don't want to make anything light out of these fiery darts, because the reality is that these fiery darts, unfortunately, are going to come our way. There's nothing we can do to stop it.
That's right.
I want that to really sink in. I understand that there may be some thoughts out there and some beliefs that, you know, we can stop these fiery darts from coming. No, we can't. These fiery darts are going to be aimed right at you, and there's nothing that you or I can do that can stop these fiery darts from coming. They're going to come. The issue is do we have the proper faith to quench the fiery darts? Do we have the proper mechanics, if you will, to stop the fiery darts from penetrating our lives to cause us great pain? I want us to understand this, first and foremost. I want to ask the question, why do these temptations come? Even though we are saved, many of us are filled with the Spirit, many of us have that understanding of the message of the cross, but yet even though we have these things, even though we've experienced these things, temptation is still coming. And the question that I want to ask is why? Why do these temptations still come on a regular basis? The answer is very simple. Everything that Satan does against you is not really against you personally. It's to weaken or destroy your faith. That's the whole purpose of these temptations. It's to either weaken your faith or to ultimately destroy your faith. And the idea that we have to, there are things that we can do to stop these fiery darts from coming is absurd. There's nothing that we can do to stop the fiery darts from being leveled against us. We have to understand, though, we do not have to let them penetrate into our lives. That's the difference.
A few years ago, I taught New Testament survey in my previous school, and the particular textbook, it may have been Hunger's textbook about New Testament survey, but he brought out something that I've never forgotten about fiery darts, is the enemy, you know, if we go back to the ancient Near East and warfare, we have spears, we have swords, bows and arrows, we have no artisanal machine guns, no missiles. So they strategically would shoot fiery darts from every direction. And part of it was, we thought the enemy's over here, but they're behind us, they're shooting them. They want those darts to come in different angles to not only cause fear, but to cause confusion and panic. And panic in the person's life. So many times as a Christian, do we get hit with something and we first would panic, and then we're just confused. We're like, Lord, I have my faith in the cross of Christ. I have my faith in the right object. I'm trusting in you and your finished work at Calvary. Why am I getting hit from the side here with this attack that seems to come out of nowhere? And it's easy for us to panic, and it's easiest for us to be confused. I've been there. I've thrown up my hands and said, Lord, I'm doing everything and all that. I said, Lord, why is this happening? And of course, you know, being real with God, you know, Lord, this isn't fair. Of course, as if we were to tell God what's fair, you know, but I think we've all been there. These fiery darts are more than, obviously, a flaming arrow is going to inflict a lot of damage, but it's not just being rained down on by these
but the reality is God allows Satan back to and there's going to be times where it feels like God is allowing more latitude, giving Satan more latitude to inflict these temptations upon us to where we feel like we're being hit from all sides. And at times there's going to be that statement where we go back to the Word and we say, Lord, you said in your Word that you wouldn't put on good on, you know, things on us more than what we can bear. But yet, it feels like you are. And there is some confusion there. There is some oppression that is there. But the reality is this, is that there's always a reason why God allows us. My grandfather made a statement, and I don't think he
say what he is tempted. wonderful thing is that when we have our faith running, we don't have to enter into that. Remember Jesus and the disciples when they were in the garden, and Jesus went out to pray, and they came back, and you know, they were sleeping, and he said, you know, hey man, could you pray with me for an hour? You know, and then one of the things he said to them, he said, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation.
Right? That's good. Well, I mean, the wording is,
there you go. Temptation's coming, or it's coming to everyone. But the key is that we need to be watching and praying. Well, the way I look at that practically is you're spiritually in tune and in line with, you know, God's covenant. You're living in the faith. You're walking. You're spiritually, you have your eyes open. About having your eyes open and like you're watching, in tune.
Taking authority over those